we are together, now we can begin. The youngest and the oldest, the only child, the twin. Some who're feeling left out, and some who're feeling in. Gathering in this place. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Gathering in this place. Here we are together, joining in this song. Even those who feel that their singing's not that strong. And as we sing, may every person know that they belong. Gathering in this place. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Gathering in this place. Here we are together, with our hopes and fears, bringing many feelings, our laughter and our tears. And now it's time for everyone to tell the world we're here. Gathering in this place. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. It's good to see you here. Gathering in this place. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you here. 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 It's good to see you. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you. Welcome everybody, it's good to see you.
Welcome everybody, good morning. Welcome to our S8 Mission Partnership Sunday worship across the S8 Mission Partnership here in Sheffield. My name is Ned. I'm the vicar of St. Peter's Church in Greenhill. It's good to be with you. From today, running through to the end of August, our online Sunday service will feel ever so slightly different. Not massively, but just ever so slightly different. One big difference will be you'll see a lot more of my face and hear a lot more of my voice. I apologise for that, for those of you who might not like that. The reason we're doing this is as we begin to transition, we hope, into putting our resources and investing our time in in-person worship once again, and trying to encourage Christians from across the S8 Mission Partnership to find corporate worship that they can engage with. Now, obviously, we're aware that for some, that will be, for a long period of time, very difficult, but we want to try and encourage as many people as possible to return to joining with brothers and sisters in person, in the flesh, to worship together. There is something very tangibly different and beneficial to joining with Christians in the same space and being with them as we worship and pray together, rather than being in isolation in our own homes. But we are aware that for some, that being at home is the only place where you can worship. And so we will continue to offer online provision, but it won't be as dedicated or as intentional as it has been over the last year and a bit. That will mean that there'll be midweek services that will be recorded and put onto the YouTube channel. There may well be live streamed services, that's particularly from St. Chad's, as they seek to do that and work out ways in which they can do that. There'll be other forms of reflections and sermons and music and things posted on this YouTube channel. So you will get here on Sundays and you'll be able to have some sort of thing to help you to reflect on God, to lead you into prayer and worship. But it just won't be a set, maybe formal service as you have known it over the last year or so, as I've said. So as we begin to see that transition, I'm going to be just making this slightly more informal, slightly more conversational. I've opened up the comments section below, and we'll be asking some rhetorical questions to help you to engage yourself in discipleship, and hopefully build relationships between yourselves as fellow viewers. So please do use that and connect with people, and find ways in which you can connect with others online as well. Over the summer, over the August month, the month of August, we'll be having sermons from across the diocese, from the senior staff, and we'll be hearing those voices, and we welcome those with great excitement. And over July, as I said, you'll hear a lot more of my voice, but it will be slightly more reflective and slightly more guided in your own reflection. So less sermon and thoughts and much more questions for you to ponder during your week. But today we are blessed to have a sermon from James at St. Chad's, and he'll be helping us to reflect on family. That's our theme for today. Family causes me to think back to a great celebration just a few weeks ago. As many of you will know, is I got married on the 19th of June to Philippa. And it was a great intimate affair. We were restricted in numbers of how many people could be there in person. Fortunately, Zoom enabled many, many others to join in and to watch us and witness us making those commitments to one another. But one of the things that I left that day feeling was how important family was to me. But family is very complicated also for me. As many of you may have heard, my family setup is complicated in that my biological family, the family that I share genetics with, that are the people I grew up with, brothers and sisters by blood, we are very different people and often have caused me a little bit of strain, perhaps. I'm not by any stretch of the imagination saying that I don't like spending time with them or that I don't speak to them anymore, but it is just strained at times. We're very different people. I wonder what your family setup with your biological family is like. Maybe you're really close to them. Maybe they bring you such joy and support, particularly over the last year and or so. But maybe, like me, it's a bit strained. Maybe you've not spoken to them for years and years. We all have different relationships with our biological family. But nonetheless, they have shaped us in one way or another. However much genetics impacts us or doesn't, depending on what you think about that, they have shaped us. The experiences of family shape us. So maybe just pause now and reflect back on how your biological family has formed and shaped you for good and maybe for ill. In the quietness, why don't you invite God to remember, to reflect on your family life with him. I can imagine that most of us will regret certain things about our biological family and our relationships with them. Maybe we have said things in the past which we regret. Maybe we haven't been in touch with them and we should have been. Maybe we have been frustrated unduly with them and expressed that in unhelpful ways. Let's just bring those regrets, disappointments, maybe hurts or pains into the presence of God, into his mercy, and just ask for his healing on you and your family. The Bible describes God as our Heavenly Father. That, in particularly in our world today, is a difficult title to give to God, because so many fathers are sources of disappointment, partly because they're human. You know, some dads are great, some dads are bad, most are a mixture, I'm sure. God is our faithful Heavenly Father. He is what fatherhood should look like. And so as we compare our earthly fathers and to our Heavenly Father, we can see perhaps some distance, some discrepancy. Maybe they don't quite match up to His heavenly standard. That's okay. They are human. And let's ask for forgiveness for them as well, for their perhaps their failings, and maybe not just fatherhood, but motherhood as well. So let's just lift those people to our Heavenly Father. So here's something for the comment section. What does it mean to you to have God as your Father? What does it mean in terms of your own relationship with your earthly father? Maybe that challenges that relationship. Maybe it enhances it and encourages it. It'd be great to hear how the relationship to God as a Heavenly Father impacts your own, as I said, biological relationships with your own family. God's love for us is so deep. He is faithful to us, as all earthly fathers should be. And so as we confess to God the breakage of relationships, the times of strain and challenge in human relationships, let's worship God and thank Him for His deep love for us.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of sin, turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. perfection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know.
As I said, my wedding day made me reflect on families, partly because I have now two adopted families, as it were, my in-laws. As many of you will know, I was married before I got married to Philippa. I was married to Sarah, and she died 3 years ago. I am still very, very close to my in-laws, her parents and her brother. And at the wedding, I paid tribute to them and asked them to continue to be considered as my mum and dad, adopted mum and dad. And I really meant that. I am very, very close to them, and they are much more involved in my life than my biological family are. And so it helps me when I'm thinking of the Birkinshaws, Sarah's parents, to understand the joys and the miracle that the church family can be. It is because of Mummy and Daddy Birkinshaw's faith that we are much closer than my biological family. It is in faith that the relationships are strengthened, that we are more committed to one another, because we are committed together in Christ. I wonder how you see the church. What is the relationship that you have with church family? And how is that different from biological family? We can find it easy, perhaps, to talk about church unity, to desire church unity. But what does that mean outside of the institution and the organisation that just so happens to be the church that you turn up to on a Sunday or connect in with? How might it be that we can become more of a family in the church with deeper relationships because of our relationship with Christ? It is with Christ that the unity is held together. That if we truly love Christ and someone else truly loves Christ, then how might it be that we truly love one another because of that intermediary of Christ? And I just invite you to hold that as we turn now to reflect on our Bible readings for today and to hear from James on his reflections about family coming out of these passages. The first reading is from Mark chapter 6, starting at verse 14. I invite you, if you're able to pause the video and go and get a Bible if you've not got one already. I'm going to just read through this. And I invite you as I read it through to be actively praying to God to speak to you about this theme of family. Maybe it's God's fatherhood. Maybe it's how we relate to one another. What themes can you draw out from this passage on the theme of family? As I said, Mark chapter 6, verse 14. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer had been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men to arrest John, bound him and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter, Herodias, came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it." And he solemnly swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" She replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent the soldier of the guards with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl, and then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came, took his body, and laid it in a tomb. Lots of challenges there in terms of where loyalties lie, perhaps, of how Herod interacts with families, etc. So I want you to bear those in mind, continue to reflect as we move in. And we turn now to Ephesians, Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1. Starting at verse 3, so do turn to that. Again, as I read this passage, be asking God to speak to you about family, to lead you to reflect on how this passage speaks to you about the theme of family. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to his good pleasure of his will. To the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things, according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory." I wonder what that says to you about family, adoption, God being our Father, adoption through Christ. What does it mean for us to be a family as the church? So we hand over now to James to lead us deeper into this theme and to help us to reflect together.
Whenever I meet with a couple who are preparing to get married, I take them through the wedding service, the promises they will make and say to each other. And when I get to the declaration section, I explain that, unlike in the films, extremely rarely does anyone have anything to say when you get to the part, "I am required to ask anyone present who knows a reason why these persons may not lawfully marry to declare it now." Usually, there's silence. I reassure them that if someone comes up and says, "You can't marry him, I'm in love with you," that isn't actually a reason in law. Age, being too closely related, or already being married to someone else are among some of the limited reasons in law to prevent marriage. Marriage makes me think of family because that is the context I was raised in, the context I grew up in. We all have families or have had them. Some are dysfunctional, some are functional, some seem completely loving and a pleasure to be in. Some families have tensions, some have drama. There's something about families that interests people and draws people in. Just look at the continued viewing figures for soaps and the success of films that explore families. In our gospel reading today from Mark, we have a very complicated family situation going on. Jesus' fame has spread to Herod, and there are various rumours about who Jesus is. A prophet, or Elijah, or maybe even John the Baptist raised from the dead. Well, the last we heard about John the Baptist in Mark's gospel, that, well, he was alive. We'll get to that point, Mark says. No, Mark is saying Jesus is much more than these. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Messiah, the Christ, the one that we have been waiting for, the anointed one. But Mark says, let me tell you about what happened to John the Baptist. Now, to explain this very difficult family, complicated family situation, I need a bit of help. So I've borrowed some of my children's cuddly toys. Now, King Herod the Great isn't the Herod in this story. King Herod the Great, the one we know from the Christmas story, the one who wanted baby Jesus dead, had a number of sons with a number of different wives. And we're focusing in on just a little bit of his family in this story. Now, one of his sons is called Philip. Here he is. This is Philip. Now, Philip married a woman called Herodias. Philip and Herodias. And they had a daughter who dances in our story for Mark. Let's call this daughter Salome, because that's probably what her name was. People pronounce it in different ways. I'll go for Salome. Anyway, something happened between Philip and Herodias. So Herodias ends up going off and getting married with, well, Herod. This is King Herod Antipas, not the great King Herod we hear about in the Christmas story. Now, awkwardly, this Herod is actually, well, a brother-in-law of, or half-brother of, well, Philip the panda. So think of the family mealtimes. I mean, that's going to be a bit awkward. But also, even more so, Jewish law, the law of Moses, actually prohibits this kind of behaviour. And John the Baptist has not been very quiet about this. John the Baptist, he is a prophet, and like any prophet in the Bible, sometimes shares things that aren't very comfortable for people to hear. Now, let's find Herodias again. Well, Herodias, Herod's new wife, doesn't like what John the Baptist is saying about her and this new marriage and all that kind of stuff. So he's not very happy about it. Has a grudge against John the Baptist and basically wants to kill John the Baptist, as we read in our Bible story. Well, Herod, he kind of likes John the Baptist. In the midst of this story, we have this really interesting verse 20. It says that Herod has some kind of respect for John and recognised that ultimately he's a good guy, a holy and righteous man, it says, and that he even protected him. Herod had liked to listen to John, it says, although Herod didn't always understand what John was talking about. He gets puzzled or greatly perplexed, as some versions put it. Well, anyway, our story really focuses in on Herod's big birthday party. He throws it, well, for himself, he's that kind of a guy. And all the significant people from around the part come, officials and military commanders, VIPs. Think of a formal black tie event with all the famous and well-to-do people gathered, sipping champagne and drinking and dining long into the night. Well, Salome, remember, she is Herodias's and Philip's daughter, dances as part of the entertainment for the evening. Well, Herod really likes the dance, and perhaps in an intoxicated state of mind, promises her anything, anything up to half of his kingdom. Of course, he wouldn't want to promise any more than that, because that would make Salome more powerful than Herod, and he wouldn't want that, would he? Well, Salome says to her mother, let's find her again, Herodias. She says, well, what should I ask for? And Herodias has this grudge against John the Baptist. So she says, John's head on a platter. That's the reply. Well, Herod has made this promise to Salome. Herod kind of wants to save face. All the important people are gathered around him at his birthday party. How would he look if he said no? So he agrees. And the order for John the Baptist's death is made. John the Baptist, the one who paved the way for Jesus, is executed because of a dance, because of a rash promise, and a complicated family marital situation. His death is so wickedly contrived. Now, one of the ways we can reflect on Bible stories is to look at the characters and maybe place our lives alongside them. Let me explain it like this. Well, Herodias. Herodias is a lady who has done something dubious in this marriage with Philip and then with Herod. It's a dubious situation, and this has led to further difficulties and challenges. And John the Baptist calls her out about it. So to handle the situation, she wants him killed, and she succeeds in this. I wonder how many times we've been in situations where our perhaps slightly dubious actions have led to further difficulties and challenges in life. Perhaps we've even been challenged by someone. I wonder, how do we take criticism and challenge from others? Do we take it as an opportunity to grow and learn? Or do we lash out? And then we have Herod. Herod, a man who knows that John the Baptist is a decent guy. But he makes a rash promise, and to save face in front of others, has John killed. I wonder, how often have we been in situations where we've cared so much, too much about our reputation, that we are prevented from doing the right thing? Our pride can get in the way of us making good decisions. And let's be honest, we all get things wrong from time to time. I mean, to be honest, quite a lot. Now, our Ephesians passage reminds us of what God has done through Jesus. Ephesians 1:7 reminds us that through Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. It's such poetic and beautiful language. Now, John the Baptist's death and Jesus' death are in some ways very similar in the way that they are both executed because of those in powerful positions or influence. They didn't want the person around. But they are quite different. Jesus' death accomplishes so much through the cross, through Jesus' blood. We can know the forgiveness for the things that we get wrong in our lives. For those times our actions are not upright. For those times that our pride gets in the way of good decisions. And this opening part of the letter is focused on what God has done in Jesus Christ. And forgiveness of sins is one of those things. It's such a great blessing to know that you are forgiven. There still may be elements of shame that linger on, and this is something we can work out with God and with others around us. But knowing God's forgiveness has such great power. Now, the opening of Ephesians doesn't just talk about forgiveness, but other things as well that God has done in Jesus Christ. And the thing I want to focus in on his family. We saw in Mark's gospel a really difficult family, a messed up family, you might say. But in and through Jesus, a new family is made. I want to share 3 points in Ephesians that raises about family. Now, firstly, in this opening part of Ephesians, a mystery is talked about. God has made known to us the mystery of his will, it says in verse 8. The word mystery here could be fourth of all translated as secret. And it's made explicit later on in Ephesians in chapter 3. It is God's plan to incorporate Gentiles, that is the non-Jews, into his family. God's family is diverse but united. You could be forgiven when reading the Old Testament to think that Israel were all that God was interested in. But looking carefully through the pages of the Old Testament, we see hints, pointers of further inclusion. The call of Abraham, he's supposed to be a blessing and his family a blessing to all nations. We see various people from outside of Israel being brought in. God's plan was always to welcome people further into his family. It's been said that Israel, a little bit like the Royal Mail, the postal service, they had the glorious good news to share with others, but they kind of kept it a little bit to themselves and did not deliver those letters, that letter of grace from God, well. And here in Ephesians, there's a reminder, hey, this is not just for you guys. And today, for those of us who call ourselves Christians, we're also called to share the good news of Jesus with others. We have amazing good news to share. Let us not forget to share it. because being a disciple of Jesus is the best thing that anyone can be at any time, in any context, in any situation, being a follower of Jesus. We as Christians must witness to others. It's what Jesus has called us, commissioned us to do. It's what he wants us to do. Secondly, family and sonship. Ephesians says we are adopted to sonship. Now, the New Testament concept of adoption to sonship applies no matter what your gender is. And let me explain it like this. In the Roman world, an adopted son was a deliberate choice of a father related to inheritance. Often these boys would have been slaves. They were legally adopted, debts cancelled, and they became a son in no way inferior to a natural born son. They had rights of a share of the father's property, and they had such a legal standing that disinheritance was impossible. Sonship in the New Testament therefore carries with it the idea of status, inheritance, permanence, a great belonging and position in God's family. And thirdly, the Holy Spirit. Being part of God's family is also, as Ephesians tells us, about receiving the Holy Spirit, this great gift from God. The Holy Spirit is like the seal that we are marked with in God's family. The Holy Spirit is like the family crest on our hearts. The Holy Spirit enables us to know that we are children of God, and the one who guarantees future promises too, the deposit we receive, and a foretaste also of what is to come. For in time, God's family will be gathered together in such closeness from every tribe and language in the new heavens and earth, with Jesus and the great family maker there at the centre. Now, I don't know what kind of family you have. I hope it isn't as complicated as the one we've looked at today from Mark's Gospel. But know that whether your family is incredible, or maybe it's less so incredible, being part of God's family is the most incredible thing. If you'd like to be part of God's family, you can ask Jesus to come into your life right now in this service. Please do get in touch with us so we can help you on your journey if this is a new decision for you. God's family is a broad family with different sorts of people in it. God's family is a place where people are adopted into it. And thirdly, God's family is where the Holy Spirit, God's presence, dwells.
Thank you, James. Lots to think about there, lots to consider. Those three points, particularly about God's family being different, being a place of authority and sonship, and of course the place, the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. Lots to consider. I wonder what you'll take away from today's service and from those readings. Do write in the comment section below what it is your takeaway. We're going to lead in now to a time of prayer, and concluding with worship. Continuing on with those themes that James has raised for us, we're gonna pray into that. We're gonna pray for God's church, particularly at this time, particularly with the challenges that it faces in lots of different ways, both locally, nationally, and globally. So let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of your church. Thank you that we are adopted, given a position of certainty and security in your love and your grace. We pray for the times when we perhaps speak ill of the church, when we focus so much on that which is wrong, and not celebrate the joy that it will be in your coming kingdom. Lord, I pray for those that have felt separate from the church for a number of months, if not over a year. For those of us who are fearful of returning to public worship of gathering with others. For those for whom relationships within the church have now become strained and we don't quite know how to go back, how to reignite friendships and relationships with others. Pray for those who've been hurt by the church, disappointed by brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, your church is the vehicle of grace for the world today. It is the means by which you are working out your purposes. And so, Lord, as baptized people, we recommit to working as part of that church, whatever way you call us to do. Just invite you to be still for a moment, to consider your place within the church, where you feel you are. Maybe you feel very much on the fringe. Maybe you feel as a bit of an isolated loner outside the church. Maybe you feel like you're looking on and seeing everyone going back to normal and you desire that for yourself. Perhaps you want to stay far away from the church as you've known it. But the reality is that God, in your baptism and in faith, has called you to be part of the church, whether you like it or not. I wonder how he might be calling you to connect in. Let's just spend a few moments reflecting and listening and discerning what God has for us and our place within the church. Lord, we pray for your national church, particularly the Church of England. Pray with all the challenges that it faces in terms of finances, in terms of sexuality and relationships, in terms of politics. Lord, it is such a mess, and we can feel so overwhelmed by it. We want so much to simplify stuff and for everyone just to understand it the way that we understand it. We are fearful of perhaps considering those that differ from us so significantly. Lord, we pray for the Church of England as it wrestles with its very understanding of who you are and your plans and purposes for the world. But we are not alone as a denomination, a particular expression of your church. Many, many others are struggling with the same issues in different ways. And with each different individual making up different and separate expressions, Lord, we pray for unity, true unity, unity that is rooted and based on the person of Jesus. Lord, we long to see that difference in unity expressed and discovered, but it will require each and every one of us to change. And so, Lord, help us. Bless those in conversations and leadership as they seek to navigate, to bring peace and reconciliation, to speak truth and to hold others in difference, but in love. And Lord, we pray for the global church. We give you thanks that the church in many developing countries and continents is the source of hope and difference. Here in Europe, the church is so established, so part of the culture, that we can often forget how transformative and different it is in other continents and other cultures. We give you thanks for brothers and sisters in Christ living the gospel in such different climates and environments. We pray for confidence and courage for them, many facing persecution, real challenges to their livelihoods and even their lives. We pray for the persecuted church, in its many forms in different locations. O Lord, give to them faith and hope and joy. It does make us reflect, Lord, on the church within Europe and in the Western Hemisphere, in the Americas, in Canada, the United States. Lord, I pray that for these more affluent areas where Christendom has been part of the culture for hundreds of years, where faith is more of a choice and can make us more apathetic, where it's not as urgent or as serious or as important in our lives and priorities, Lord, I pray that you would set your church on fire. Lord, may we be aware once more of your amazing grace that changes lives. May we be touched once more by that life-changing realization of what it means to follow Jesus and to be his disciples. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory.
Amazing grace.
coming to the end of our time together. And here's where it might be slightly different. I'm going to set you some homework, some challenge, and we're going to touch back on those things, check in on them next week at the beginning of the service. What I want you to do this week is to continue to consider your own family situation. It might be that you have particular difficulties with your biological family at this point in time. And maybe this week you want to work on how you might reach out to them, how you might be peacemakers and peace builders in those relationships. It might be that you have a difficult relationship with in-laws or adopted families. Again, how might you be peacemakers or peace builders in those relationships? But I think most importantly, what I want you to think about is your place within the church. Maybe it is that you want to draw a picture with a tree. And on that tree represents the church. And you might want to draw people in your church family and where you think and where you see them in the church. And make sure that you include yourself in that picture. Where are you in relation to the tree? Are you looking at it from a distance? Are you struggling to get into the branches? Maybe you're falling out of the church. Place yourself somewhere on that tree and place others and label them and consider them. And as you consider those different members of your local church, pray for them. Maybe you haven't spoken to them for a while. Maybe you don't know what the pandemic's been like for them. I encourage you to reach out, to contact the clergy if you don't have their telephone number, to say, you know what, I want to connect with this brother or sister in Christ. How might I do that? What news have you got of these people? How might I pray for them? So I encourage you to connect in with that. So as well as doing that sort of peace building in your family relationships, maybe just draw a picture and enter into that exercise over this week. Maybe come back to it each day and choose someone different in the church. As I said, we'll check in on how you're getting on with that the beginning of next week. So there's your homework for this week. As I said, please do use the comments section. Share some reflections that you've had from James's sermon or perhaps from some of the questions that I've been asking during this service. As I said, we are heading in September, hopefully to maybe slightly more investment in in-person worship. That's not to say that we're going to get rid of online worship in any stretch of the imagination. You will always be able to turn up on a Sunday on this YouTube channel and find resources for discipleship and worship. So please do continue to use it. But we really want to encourage you to consider your place within in-person and public worship. It's such a blessing. And you may have forgotten what a blessing it is, but it really is important in our discipleship and our encouragement in faith. So we want to encourage you to do that. Connect in through the websites. Details are in the information section below this video. Do connect in with all the local churches. It may be that through the pandemic, you are feeling like your particular church that in the Mission Partnership, maybe you're feeling slightly distant from it, but we encourage you maybe to connect in with one of the other churches in the Mission Partnership, at which point you're still in relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ, but maybe you're being asked to move somewhere different in the Mission Partnership. That's absolutely fine. Why not check out their details of what they're offering in our different local contexts? So I hope you have a good week. Hope that the exercise is helpful and fruitful, that you build relationships with brothers and sisters in the church, and we'll see each other next week. God bless you. Peace be with you.